give me a governor, y'all. Don't let it spin out of control. Don't get to the point where you're forced because we've indulged so much that we can't even eat no more. You know what I'm saying? Now we gotta be on the liquid diet, you know, and that's in everything. In your marriage, in your finances, whatever. Like, don't get to the point where somebody else has to take control of your life because you lost control. Get to a point where you're like, enough is enough. Put a plan together, get you an accountability partner, and turn it around.
Today's show is brought to you by Organifi. Organifi is an organic superfood supplement line that makes quality, trusted nutrition convenient and accessible. Their most popular product, the green juice, solves the problem of juicing greens on the go. We all know that we need to get those fruits and greens and vegetables and all that in our diets, guys, and here's a quick and easy way to get it. You just add water, drink, and let your body soak up the benefits. Visit Organifi.com to learn more about an exciting offer for you, our podcast listeners. That's Organifi, O-R-G-A-N-I-F-I.com.
I wake up every single day. I am who I say I am, and I get what I get because I live in beast mode. Stop being gazelles. You're not average. You're not even good. You were born to be great.
What's going on, world? Welcome to another edition of the Secret to Success podcast. I'm your host, CJ, joined as always by the Bayesian sensation, Mr. Carl W. Hey. Wesley, if you're nasty, Phillips.
Not the nasty, feeling sensational. Wesley, what's going on?
Yeah, what's going on? Also joined live from the APOC studio. You know what I'm saying? Felt like... And my spirit told me you were at church. I don't know why. Yeah. Just in the booth somewhere, in the recording booth.
Oh, no question. That's exactly where I am.
Hey, are we going to get a recording booth up there?
We got one. Jamie is working
already
on it.
In there. It came with the building.
Yeah, it came with the building. We just got to pray that Jamie don't charge us too much to finish it off. To cap it off. Well,
hey, he got to eat too, dog. He got to eat too.
I promise you. Oh, he eating good.
But Carl told me, I just found out y'all didn't even have church over there this week. I'm like, what's going on?
Never. No. We're waiting. It's like a fresh pair of shoes, bro. Like, only cats who don't get shoes wear theirs straight out. Like, you brand spanking new to the game, you wear them out the store. If you are used to something, as my mama used to say, if you're used to something, you keep them in the box until first day of school or, you know, like a special occasion. So, we're not going to open the building up until everybody can come and celebrate together.
So I guess that's cool then, because I'll be there for the grand opening. Yeah, I appreciate you holding off of me, man.
No question.
Yeah, I feel good about that. Catch me up, man. Holiday weekend, Memorial Day. Did y'all do some barbecuing? What else was going on? We got to catch up before we get into it. I ain't talked to y'all.
So I went pretending to be, you know how you do it. You got kids and we're going to go outside. God bless us. I'm talking about a beautiful day up here yesterday. The whole weekend was 60, beautiful.
Was it 68?
I'm talking about, 68. Yeah. It's the perfect balance of the 68. Sun is nice and hot, but you got that cool breeze. Perfect balance. So I caught myself trying to be outside being young and playing some soccer with Jordan. And y'all, needless to say, like, you know, I can count by six different parts of my body that I didn't know I had right now. Like some of my ankle, like it's a weird spot, like that little, the instep, I think they call it. Like that little, I ain't flat footed, so that little curve in there, like that joint, I don't know if Jordan kicked me or if I stood on the ball or something, but that joint, so I'm talking about, I can't even walk
orthopedic Skechers.
Oh, man.
I need to get them Joe Montana Skechers.
Joey Montana.
Hey, that's another sign when you know you're getting old, when you go for comfort and not cute. You know what I'm saying?
Joey Montana. Hey.
Like, look, I don't care nothing about y'all. I got these 7-inch platform sneakers on. They make my back feel delicious.
I'm talking about delicious. Hey, and then also, Carl, with the shoes, start taking a bear a day. You know what I'm saying? An aspirin a day.
Now you definitely getting older. You taking Bayer. You got to have like a 40-year-old license to even get Bayer. Hey, like, what you mean Bayer? You better get a Tylenol.
RP card. Yeah, AARP card. Get your car.
Oh, just no that doubt. Joker. That come with get the bear. They got a bear sample bear. Pack on that
you
joint.
Feel me? You feel
yeah.
me?
Wow.
That way, if you have a heart bear. Attack or anything, you good to go. You covered. So just drop yeah. one of them jokers every day in your Organifi, and then you
wow.
solid.
Yeah. Wow. Oh, yeah. Wow. I promise wow. you, bro. Yeah, I'm right that, there with you, Carl. I dove in the pool the other
weekend.
Day. Pulled a rib muscle. I was like, yeah, that's it for that.
Wow, swimming's supposed to be the easiest exercise.
But you know, that's not what I'm saying. All. As you get older, you just start crossing stuff off your list that is no longer attainable. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, riding bikes,
without
nope,
stretching.
Didn't pull my hamstring yeah. doing that. We crossed yeah. that out. You know
hey,
what I'm saying?
Truly, we can finally act our age now. I can act my age. I don't have to do that no more.
No, you ain't got to impress nobody. My list yeah. is all the way down to speed walking, dog. And by speed, it's all relative based on, you know what I'm saying, what you think speed is.
Yeah. So, yeah. Well, you know, hey, you know how I do it. See, you know, my what? Holiday, I called Jamie on Sunday. I called Jamie on Friday. I'm like, yo, Jamie, this is how we could do it. You can cook. I got bread. All right. So I buy the groceries. You cook the meal. You feel me? Jamie was like, man, I don't know if I'm cooking or not. I'm like, bro, I'm paying for it. He's like, all right, I'm cooking. So I drove over to that joker. He had about 8 pans. We had to give stuff away. I was like, yo, we can't eat like this, Jamie, for 3 days. Like, this is, you do this once. You know, Jamie had enough stuff to cover us for the entire week, bro. But, oh, Jamie, bro, let me tell you something. Jamie can, oh, I mean, he take his time, but, oh, the boy can, he can
what did
throw
he, what did he cook?
Down. Well, you know, he cooked a lot of stuff for himself. I couldn't have all of that. But he cooked, oh
where
Carl,
was I?
Didi, now Carl, Didi was like, she was 80% because she passed some stuff out to the Phillips family, but she didn't give him the sweet corn he made. He made some
so
sweet
she
corn.
Held back something.
Oh, the sweet corn, bruh. Mm. And the he had the sweet corn. He had chicken.
Oh, it's nothing like the sweet corn when it get warm outside.
Bruh, he had the sweet corn, bruh. But only thing that they gave us, and I was like, I ain't gonna lie, I think he might have rushed it or something, or maybe I'm just getting old. He made, I don't know, Jamie make mac and cheese for everything. I'm like, it's Memorial Day, bruh. Nobody know mac and cheese for Memorial Day. It's not Thanksgiving. You know what I'm saying? And I think that was pretty much it.
Mac and cheese is not seasonal, by the way. Mac and cheese is
mac and cheese
every day. What are you talking about?
I'm with Jamie. I can't do that for Memorial Day. Yeah, I'm like, not for Memorial Day, Jamie. I'm
you
trying to
do,
just
yeah, no, nah, you no, nah, I feel what you're saying, but you gotta have the mac and cheese, dog. What other sides did y'all have?
That was it, the corn. Yeah, that was it. Corn and I just was like, let's hit the, you know me, y'all. I ain't gonna lie. I took a hot dog bun from his crib and laced it with the chicken. You know what I'm saying? And the barbecue sauce he made, I was good to go. I just had a taste for
the sandwich king is back.
Oh man, I'm talking about back. I hadn't had grilled chicken in forever, bro. So I'm like, yo, and Mike will do it, but Mike went like Mike be going up north like 50-60% of the time. Every holiday they go up north. So I don't get the
that's what my cousins
him.
Do on that side of the family.
Oh
you know
yeah,
what I'm
no
saying?
Question.
We go up north.
No question.
For those of y'all listening. For those of y'all listening who are not from Michigan, come on, man. We got to do a better job explaining to people the inside stuff because we got listeners all the way over the seas. So when you live in Michigan, going up north, we have what we call cottages or lake houses or whatever else. But they're all up north from Lansing, Detroit area. So usually my white side of the family will go up north. Now, only reason I'm not trying to be racist here, I've never heard nobody black say they're going up north unless they were going with somebody white. Okay?
Right.
So, you know what I'm saying?
That's
you know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like anybody black who been up north, you went with somebody who was white. So anyway, shout out to my family with the cottages up north.
I never even heard of up north till I moved to Lansing.
We try not to tell y'all about that.
No
you know
question.
What I'm saying? We try to keep
you
some
did a good
stuff.
Job. Oh,
we try to keep some stuff separate, but equal.
You did a very
you know
good job.
Well, I'm gonna tell y'all one of the things I love most about being mixed is I can make black and white jokes and nobody can call me racist.
Oh, you got the perfect.
You know what I'm saying? It's like, now you can't say nothing to me, dog. I got the best of both worlds. But anyway, going up north, it's nothing like it. Yeah, no, it's nothing like going up north. Usually you just got, you know, on the lake, you got a nice little lake house, a cottage, and you barbecue, jet skis, you know, you just do the whole nine. So Yeah, no, I got you. Hey, so you sound like you eating up there. How's the post Jamaica bodies? Hey, they sounding like they might be a little doughy up north.
I'm sorry to do this to you on the podcast, E, but this weekend watching you at church, I'm like, yeah, E back. Chunky E back. I saw that guy just looking
love
at
it,
me
bro.
A little bit.
He's back.
Let me tell you
like
something.
Mike with the 4.5.
I promise you, bro. And I promise you, I ran the other day and I was like, yo, E, don't get back into running. Like, you enjoying life, bro. Like, don't kill yourself. I'm just being real, see? I'm like, E, don't kill yourself for, what do you call it? Don't kill yourself for a public appearance, bro.
No.
It's like, I'm at the best. I'm talking about my girl is loving me. We having the time of our lives. I'm like, bro, I'm not interested. I get up and go walking every morning for an hour. And I did it like a 2-mile run the other day. I was like, I'll do that like maybe 2-3 times a week. But bro, I'm telling you, I'm feeling way better now than I did. I'm like, bro.
Let me tell you something. Them sermons been fire.
Oh, no doubt. Chunky E is back. Yo.
Oh, I'm just saying, bro. I love it.
I told Didi the other day, I was like, D, to count my calories and all that, yeah, I can't do it.
You still got to stop it in this tracks, though, E. We don't need you going too far now. You know what I'm saying? You're doing
summer.
The sandwiches.
You got to control it in the summer, E, because wintertime coming around again quick.
Let me tell y'all something. I'm just going
to have to go on that all-black diet like I did. Hey, for those of y'all who missed it, that's where you just wear all black. It make you look slimmer.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
But I'm saying, I got for those of you who are listening, don't you go back, because I told you, I'm sweet in all the other areas. I'm sweet, right? But the one thing I realized is that to be skinny... And from me and my family, it's just too much work, bro. Like, ain't none of us skinny, bro. And to get skinny, it take a lot of work. I'm just like, God,
quiet
I tried
as kept.
For
you
five
was skinny
years.
When you had to get rebaptized. You was angry because you was hungry. You were angry.
That's what it was.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's what it was.
He needed a Snickers so bad. Yeah. That's why he had to get rebaptized. You was snapping on folks because you was vegan. You know what I'm saying?
Here's the crazy part. I told Didi, I was like, Didi, here's the crazy part. And this will make it real bad. And I promise you. On everything I love. Didi was like, okay, it just flows different. I'm still in a large, see? And I'm still in a 33 waist. My waist ain't changed. My shirt size ain't changed. It just spread out differently. You know what I'm saying? It just spread out differently.
Like mayonnaise.
It's softer, that's all.
Yeah. You feel me?
Yeah, bro. No, hey, as long as you're still in a large, dog.
No, but I was at Michigan State, bro. I promise you, I was a 2X. I was like, D, I don't get it. I was in a 2X and I'm in a large. And she was like, nope, it's just spreading your shoulder. yeah, you know what I'm saying? She's like, it's in your shoulders, it's in your back. I'm like, okay, cool. But I'm just being real. It's people who are listening and they going.
Your weight went to your shoulders?
Yeah, it's in my shoulders, bro. Like, and somebody told me the other day, it was so funny. Some dude was like, yo, E, you looking buff, bro. You working out. And I was like, nah, it's just, it's not what you think, bro.
I appreciate that, bro.
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
I didn't want to bust his bubble, but he was like, yo, E, you lifting? I was like, yeah, but not, I'm not lifting weights. Yeah, I'm not lifting weights, bro. Yeah, so no. I got to say this, C, because for real, there are people who be like, all right, E, chill, I chill. Listen to me very closely. Do not chill. If you're not at a certain financial place, you're not at a certain...
I'm just saying,
you ain't number one in your career, you know what I'm saying? You can't... for real, you got to go ahead and do it. And specifically, if you got the type of female who wants you to have a body, you got to respect your wife.
Oh,
I just was blessed. Yeah.
That's
I just was
why
blessed
I always
that my girl
tell you,
ain't
I came that. Into the relationship, you know, soft. You know what I'm saying? So,
you did. It was, oh, yeah,
you
know, no, C got it easy.
I had a low bar.
Yeah, you got it
you know
easy.
What I'm saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, C my wife ain't tripping. Yeah. Nah.
C if was the way mortgage,
if the mortgage stopped getting paid, yeah, we might have beef. You know what I'm saying? But she definitely not tripping on these chocolate chip cookies.
Your dad sent us a photo of you this week. I don't know, probably like out of high school, E. You saw it, right?
Oh,
you
was
working at Rite Aid. When was that?
High school.
Bro, that was 15, in high school.
15, yeah,
in high school?
How about that?
Oh, yeah.
That was in high school.
I'm talking about Candace was, came up, bro, from then to where you
was,
at. Now
was,
Candace came up.
Number one recruit in the state. You feel me?
Yeah. No, that was that. Yeah, that was that look. Yeah, C got it
that
easy.
Was the look.
Yeah, C got it easy because C was chunky.
Oh,
so,
I was huge.
He ain't going to never get back to that. Like,
No. I told you. That's why I can still see people from high school. It don't matter what side. They like, dang, you look great. I'm like, yep, see? Y'all started off skinny. You know what I'm saying? Then got chunky. You know what I'm saying? I just went ahead and hit that reverse button. You know what I mean? Got mine out the way. But either way, hey, you know what? As long as I stay away from all the bread and sweets, I'm going to be solid. But E, and I don't really have a sweet tooth like that.
I don't have
but
no I know sweet tooth, but I got the bread, catch, boy.
Yeah, you got the bread and you like the sweets a little bit.
Yeah, I do like the sweets a little bit, but I ain't got to have those. I got to have bread. And here's what I said, though.
Because you've been in Michigan, though, so you ain't had no Grand Lux, no butter cake to worry about or nothing like that.
No, you're right, because we're not here. But I was saying the other day, I was talking to Royce. I mean, Roy. Roy had hit me up, and he was just telling me, you know, about his father's health. He wasn't doing 100%, you know, but he was like, he's still in his right mind, working every day. And so he was like, I was like, how's he doing? He's like, yo, E, he had a little situation, you know, not too long ago. I was like, what was it? And he was telling me about, you know, him eating candy bar. And I was like, yo, that's crazy. My old dude, you know, he got MS, and they was out in Cali doing their thing, and he had like a huge health scare. I don't know if y'all remember, just before Jamaica, right? Yeah. And so my mom, I was like, yo, Ma, what happened? She thought he had an MS relapse. She's like, yo, he ain't had an MS relapse in 20 years. Come to find out, my man OD'd off of paydays, Snicker bars, just OD'd, right? And I was talking to Roy about it, and Roy was like, yo, E, I ain't gonna lie to you, bro. He's like, what happens is, when they get a certain age and they have been disciplined all those years, it's just like, at some point, you just like, is it worth it? And my struggle with bread, see, I just was like, yo, bro, like, I crave it too much, and when I'm off, it's like a crackhead with no crap. I'm like, E, go ahead.
Yeah, that's when you had to get rebaptized. I'm trying to tell you. It's all going back to diet. You thought something was wrong with your spirit. It was your gut. You feel me? You was hangry, dog. You seen them Snickers commercials where they be pissed off as soon as they get a Snickers. They be like, ha, ha, ha. Let me tell you something. Chunky E ain't never had an attitude.
Yeah, no.
I'm talking about happy. The flamingo come all the way out.
He's happy. Yeah, when I got that sandwich yesterday, I ain't gonna lie. I laced that hot dog bun, bro, with the chicken. I put some corn on top of it.
Oh, did you put mayonnaise on it?
Nope. I had the barbecue sauce. I ain't need none. Oh. I had the barbecue sauce. Mm. I put the barbecue sauce on top of that. Didi was like, what you doing? She was like, I see what you're doing, bro.
What kind of barbecue sauce?
Jamie made like homemade barbecue sauce.
Oh, okay. What kind of barbecue sauce do y'all use in general, though?
Oh, sweet baby.
Important question. I should have done it as a segment.
Is there something other than Sweet Baby Ray?
I was going to say, Sweet Baby Ray is the only one I know.
Oh, that's what y'all do. We do that, too. I don't do barbecue sauce like that, but my wife is addicted. She like eat with bread, with barbecue sauce. No, we do Sweet Baby Ray's, but I know I came from a Bullseye family.
Oh, yeah, and I never had that.
Oh yeah, Bullseye.
Does Kraft have one? I think we had. I forgot the one we used to do.
You talking about Open Pit?
Open Pit is what my parents
open
used
pit
to do.
Give you a little open zing pit. Now. Don't slip open on pit. Open Pit. Open Pit definitely will take you to that next level. But we do Sweet Baby Ray's original right now. You know what I mean? That's pretty much what we are. So, but we've been slightly disciplined over here, man. We had the King family in town this weekend, and so you know, definitely. Oh, I put them on the Jets pizza this weekend, and they were crazy. They had never had Jets.
Which one? What you do?
Jalen was here, so you know Jalen had to order the barbecue chicken.
The barbecue chicken.
The only one I'll
do. That's dangerous.
Yeah, I don't like it, but that's the only
Jalen
one
got
I'll
the
do.
Barbecue chicken pizza, but let me tell you something. The King family, they from Chicago. They know pizza, and I kept telling them, like, okay, this pizza ain't Chicago, but it's
straight.
Yeah, it's solid, and they were like, So, yeah, no, they were geeked up. But, we had a good weekend, man. Of course, we had Game Changers down here. Shout out to all my Game Changers that came through. All of them that got certified. We have a whole new crop of certified speakers, E, that are just incredible, man. Really doing their thing. Follow the Instagram page, too, ETA Game Changers. All of our speakers who learn the art of professional speaking, turning their passion into a profit, they came down this weekend. We had a grand old time. Again, as always, they did an incredible job. Shout out to Cantus for, you know, running another amazing event. Kendall Val, all the coaches always do a great job there. And you know what? Can I give a special shout out? This don't have nothing to do with nothing, and I'm about to change up the topic. But I've been so grateful for them, and I never get a chance to say it on the podcast. And y'all gonna, as soon as I say it, y'all gonna be like, "Yep, see you right to hijack the podcast with this." But can I give a special shout out to Fatai and Ray?
Oh, yeah.
No question. Man,
no question.
For those of y'all in the BU community,
the real MVP.
You know them, yeah, no for those question. Of y'all in the BU community, y'all know them very well. But for those of y'all who just listen to the podcast and you're not in BU yet, shame on you. But Ray and Fatah, they literally come, man, to all the events.
Everything.
And they work from the time they get there to the time we leave. Let me tell y'all something. I'm talking about, sometimes I'm like, man, y'all came all the way here and they would work at the product table from the time they get there to the time they leave. Like, they won't even hear E speak. And I'm like, wow, you know what I mean? So it's just been on my heart, literally. I don't even know why. It's just been on my heart, literally, to thank them. And I was like, yo, let me do it publicly. Because, you know, we got people who rock with us for real, man. And it means a lot. And, I, you know, every time I tell them, I try to say it. But I don't know if it sticks. So hopefully, man, it sticks and y'all hear it on the podcast. But love you guys and thank you guys a million for all the support. Go ahead, E.
No, I'm just saying, and not take a picture with me.
Oh yeah, that's what I'm saying. Just no, they
I'm
literally
saying,
just no intentions
there.
Other than to serve,
bro.
And that,
I didn't
you know, that
know
that
there.
Deserves, you know what I mean, credit. Like we talked about from before.
Yeah.
So shout out to Fatah and Ray. Hey, I got a question. Okay, I should new segment. It's called Quick Question. All right, new segment. Quick question. Nothing deep. What is the proper etiquette for, and from the server standpoint, and you as a patron? When you give the waiter or waitress your card at the end of the meal and it doesn't get accepted and they bring it back. Can we talk about that real quick? Because I was actually out this weekend and, you know, I was feeling pretty good about myself. I was like, hey, everybody, put your cards away. This is, you know, you try to do it like a boss. You know what I'm saying? Like, hey, so everybody like, oh, see, you shouldn't have. Everybody So they come back. Now, you know, everybody's talking, so it's, you know, it's not like all eyes on me type of deal. But I don't know what was going on. But before I explain how this interaction went down, I just want to know how y'all handle it. Because I don't feel like I handled it the best, okay? So I just want to know how y'all would handle that or in those situations. How do you handle that? And what's the proper etiquette, both from the server and from you?
I'm trying to think of the. Obviously, we don't eat out nearly as much. My parents been here throwing it down, so we ain't eating out nearly as much. I'm trying to.
Has your card ever been declined at the restaurant, Carl? If not, then we can move on because I know E's has.
I'm sure it happened with one of these ETA cards. I told y'all like last week how Chase be shutting us down, so I'm sure it's happened, but I can't remember. Like I don't remember the interaction at all.
Okay, E.
Yeah, I'm trying to think.
E, you're on mute.
Right.
Help us out. Hip hop page. Y'all hear me? Hip hop preach.
Now we hearing you. Yep.
Leave that in there too, Eddie. Don't edit that. Just let the people know how imperfect this podcast is. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no. You know, I was trying to think about it. I was like, I don't know if there's a
y'all,
way to do it.
So you mean to tell me y'all have never been out of the restaurant, put your card in the little booklet, and they came back and said, excuse me. And then they try to be nice, call you by your name because they saw it on the card. Excuse me, Mr. Quinney. You know, y'all never had that?
And you know what, though? I think I never had it because every time I go, I do that. It's funny, but I tease and go, hey, what if something happened to my car? What y'all gonna make me do? Wash the dishes? Or I'll ask them. I'm like, yo, for real, what's the process when somebody can't pay you? Like, what do you do? And so I think because I always ask, I put it out there. It's never happened to me before. But no, as crazy as it seems, at a restaurant, it's never happened. I told y'all, it's happened to me at a department store, you know, once or twice, but never happened to me in a restaurant.
I guess that's kind of like, similar. I guess, okay.
Yeah, but the restaurant to me is so much more dramatic because they walking a long distance.
Yeah,
they coming
and it's
back,
like you already made me go way back here for this Fugazi car.
Yeah, it's kind of dramatic. Whereas like when I'm at Macy's and I'm standing right next to homegirl, it ain't really that deep. Like,
car.
It didn't work. I was like, all right, try it again. You know what I'm saying? Like, it should be like, all right.
Wait.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
you told her to try the same one again?
Yeah, try it again. Something wrong.
Oh, no, that's way too too bold. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, just try it again.
No, sir.
Yeah. No, try it again. No, I know doggone well. I know I got money. You know what I'm saying? I know it's some money on there. Enough to cover the little. Did he spend $52?
And there goes the pride I was looking for. That's
I'm
the
saying
pride $52. I had. You know what I'm saying? Why did I start explaining my whole financial situation to the waitress? She was looking like, sir, I don't care. I was like, look, hey, That's crazy. My limit should be I start going way into my financial banking history, trying to prove to her that I wasn't some broke. I said, wow. And then I finally gave her another car. She walked away and I was like, you are so lame. Like, how lame could you be? Baby girl didn't ask for none of that information. You done ran down the fact that you the president of ETA. Oh, Lord, it was embarrassing.
Okay, yeah.
I embarrassed my whole.
That's a bit much.
I was like, look, you know ET, right? Hold on, let me pull out my Instagram. Like, dog, it was just bad, dog. I handled it terribly. And I was just trying to see if anybody, because my pride was hurt. You know what I'm saying? Because she saw me deny everyone's card at the table. As if I had the big ball, the big joker. You know what I'm saying?
That ain't it. You are a gorilla, dog. You know what I'm saying? You're private,
I didn't like
bro.
That, though. Because when she came back. Now, she handled it, you know, I think pretty well. Because she came back and she bent over and, like, you know, had a little conversation. She said, sir, for whatever reason, I like that. Because she didn't say like insufficient funds. She said, for whatever reason, this card in particular is not taken at this time.
Right.
I thought that was actually very eloquent.
I like that. Yep.
Now, why did I still get defensive even though she said it like that? I will never know. You know what I'm saying? Because it wasn't like she was like, sir, this card ain't even working. She was very professional. She knew that perhaps there was another challenge with the card other than financial reasons. So anyway, man, I went way too deep in explaining my financial history to...
Yeah, whenever you go out, if you feel like, see, when they come back, just say, you know what I'm saying? Like, they protect fraud. You know what I'm saying? It's a lot of fraud going on.
Oh, so I couldn't even get quick enough to say none of that. Yeah. I was so shocked.
They're protecting me against myself. That's all. They don't even know it's me.
Oh, so you just say it was fraud?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So it might have been a fraud attempt on this card.
No
so.
Question. Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
You forgot to call your bank and tell them you was going out to eat.
Now, here's the thing. The bad part is... Now you're playing Russian roulette when you give the other card. You know what I'm saying? Now the chips, you know what I'm saying, are really on the table when you try to boss up and be like, oh. You give them that
take my
one and
American
they get
Express card.
Yeah, you gotta do the dash. You know what I'm saying? That's when you just get loose on everybody. So anyway, luckily the second card did not have the same issues as the first card. I was able to, and then you know you got to overcompensate on the tip. I tipped her like 88%.
Oh, no
you know what I'm saying?
Oh, no doubt.
Just to let her know, hey, if you see this face again, I'm not the broke guy. So anyway, the male ego is fragile. That's long story short. All
was right? that the Thomas and Ash? Which one was
you said
denied?
What?
Which one was denied? The ET and Ass? Was that the one that was denied? Associates.
Let me tell you something. That one is
that
always
really
denied.
Bad. Yeah, that'll really look bad. Where's ET? Is this Tarik Thomas?
I just got another card that still says that. It still says that. Let them in on the inside joke, Carl.
Every card that we've
I'm sure
got
we've said it before,
Thomas,
but it might have been years ago since we talked about it.
Dude, it's hilarious. Whoever is designing these cards, they have the worst sense of humor possible or the best, depending on how you look at it. But they make the abbreviation for Eric Thomas and Associates. It's a lot of characters. I get it. You can't fit that whole long thing on a card. So they make it absolutely this. Eric Thomas and ASS. Eric Thomas and Ass. So CJ gets
you know
one. I get the
other. You know what I'm saying?
And left cheek and right cheek. That's who we are.
Hey, no wonder your car getting turned down. You know what I mean? They're like, oh, yeah. No. Is Eric Thomas here? Oh, well, this is Ass. You know what I'm saying? So anyway, that's about as R-rated as this podcast gets, ladies and gentlemen. Don't worry about it. It's actually short for, I think, donkey. So we're good. All right.
Just explain that to your
okay,
kid.
So E and I had an interesting conversation, I believe either over text or something or another. But E was saying to me, what were we talking about, E? Help me out. Can you phrase it? Because I was saying that it was belief and you considered it to be a effort-related thing. So when we talk, I guess what we were talking about was, Carl, when you know you have to do something, right? So like somebody, you know, is well aware of the fact that they need to get a task done. They need to lose weight, better their financial situation, go get an education, whatever those things were. You kind of break down how the conversation started because it started between you and I over the text. I'm actually about to look through my text and see if I can find exactly what we were saying. But I told you that I disagreed with you on the issue. So I figured, hey, let's just
Yeah. So in short, you know what I'm saying? You know, always it could be a couple categories, but I felt like I finally found the reason for poverty. You know, like I hadn't
That was it. Yep, gotcha.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I I'm always thinking, bro, like, fortunately or unfortunately, you know, I'm somebody's mentor, you know, somebody's pastor, whatever. And so for me, it's like, I feel it's my duty when I overcome something or I become successful in the area for me to do a better job of communicating. Because that's been one of the challenges that people have. Like, yo, E, you didn't necessarily communicate effectively. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, okay, you got to do a better job of not just telling people that they need to overcome in a certain area, but you also need to find out, you know, like, what is the secret to success? Like, what are the tangible steps from getting from point A to point B? Because I'm kind of like a big picture kind of guy, like generalization. Like, I don't really get specific. So it's like, I'm trying to do a better job. So I call C like, aha, I got it. Poverty was something that I was having a hard time with. Like, I was having a hard time trying to explain to people the process from going from poverty to wealth. And not like the physical things that you had to do, the tangible things, but more the mindset. Like, so I was struggling, like, yo, I can't get people to really get it, because people who are in poverty, they had this particular mindset, and to make that shift is not hard, but it is. So I was like, yo, see, I got it. Like, I get it now. I know what the problem is, you know? So I started explaining to CJ, like he said, from my perspective, you know what I'm saying, what I thought it was, you know what I'm saying? And then C was like, nope, it's not that. It's not, you know, it's not an effort thing. It is a whatever he said it was. So let's help.
Yeah,
the people
I said
out.
Belief, but let me say, and I'm looking at the text right now. But you basically said that, and when you say poverty, we're not necessarily talking about like poor people, right? Like,
right.
That's not what we're saying in general. But we are talking about habits of people who maybe are not, you know, in the greatest financial situation. Does that make sense? Okay, cool.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure people don't know that we're not literally saying this is the cause of poverty, right? Like, we're talking about a mindset
and people,
here.
Yeah, and but also, see, they got to understand, and people who have access to financial resources and still not, you know, where they want to be, if that makes sense. So for
people, and one thing he said that what he thought was the main cause was that people put the reward before work. And your, I guess, opinion of that was that we always put the work and then got the reward, which is traditionally how it works. So explain to us what you mean by they get the reward before the work. Obviously, we understand what it means, but break that down for us. And then I'll say, and I don't even know if we were having so much as a disagreement as I was just trying to then add on what I believed about it. So what do you mean by that in terms of the poverty mindset of reward before work?
Yeah, so when I first explained it, Carl, I explained it, you know, in a way that people can get it, and then I try to go a little deeper. So on a real surface level, tangible level, you'll have a person who wants, let's say, an Escalade, right? And to get an Escalade would literally be to exhaust your budget completely. You feel me? Like, if you bought it, or there are people who may say, you know, they're looking for an apartment and they want you know, they want to stay in Buckhead, you know, and stay in a luxurious apartment in Buckhead, you know. But if you do that, you probably are exhausting every dime you have, and you're going to be living from check to check to check, right? So I said, what people with a poverty mindset do is go, this is what I want. You know what I'm saying? Like, this is like, you know, like, if I was to be handling my business, if I was, you know, doing everything I was supposed to be doing, this is how I would live. So before they actually do all the stuff that you're supposed to do, they reward themselves as if they're doing that, right? So they reward themselves, you know, somebody might say, I went 30 days on a strict diet. So I guess on the 31st day, I've heard people who are like, you know, people who are really in shape and into the physical boy, they still have cheat days. Right. So they'll say it's a reward, but they will wait until that 31st day for that reward. And then they'll go another maybe 30 days of eating strictly, you know, and working out and doing what they're supposed to do. And then it's like, all right, another, you know, 60 a second day. All right, reward. But then there are some people, you know, like myself, definitely when it comes to food, I'm like rewarding on the reg. You know what I'm saying? Like, I live on reward. You feel me? And so I was just telling C, I just feel that there are people, and I mean, I'm being for real. There
are people. Did you say you live on reward as it relates to
food? Oh, I live on reward. Yeah, I live on reward. Meaning that, it's always something celebratory. It's like a, what do you call it? Like somebody might have a graduation, so we go out to eat afterwards. You know, I go to church weekly. We eating every, like after church regularly. So there's another person who like, for real, like they're really health freaks and that's like their strength. So they will still go to the graduation, but they won't celebrate like that. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's three, like, for real, let's be real. It's like high school graduation, college graduations. You know what I'm saying? And I really look at it and go, when it comes to
that's a problem. I think that's a real problem. And shout out to one of our game changers, Bobby, who talked about that. Is like, food is a reward system in the States. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. It's like, this don't have nothing to do with what he was talking about. But it's just like, yo, think about it.
No.
Like,
but it's
you,
real.
You win the spelling bee, it's like, pizza.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, I'm saying, it's just a part of the, it's a part of the culture. Now, everybody doesn't do it. And I'll be honest with you, in most of my areas, I don't. Like, I don't wake up at 8 o'clock in the morning. You know what I'm saying? I get up early. You know what I'm saying? In a lot of other areas, I'm super disciplined. But just so people can understand what I'm talking about, not think that I'm, you know what I'm saying, like trying to act like I'm above life, in the area of food, that's the probably one area where I'm going to reward myself, meaning I'm going to eat what I like. Without saying, all right, did you do 3 miles today? I don't care if I ran 3 miles or not. If I feel like eating chicken, I'm eating chicken. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not on that. I didn't run today. You feel what I'm saying? Like, that's just not my thing. But when it comes to my house, I haven't bought that $1 million house yet because I was like, yo, E, don't do that. Like, keep working, and keep piling up. And then when you get the $1 million crib, it's going financially, is not going to make a difference, just like this house don't make a difference. So this house is paid for. So when I get the $1 million house, I will probably get as close to paying it off as possible. So when I get that, it doesn't change, you know, my financial standard of living. But what I said was most people live on reward in every area of their life. You know what I'm saying? So most people, they don't have one or two areas.
Right,
like
right,
there are people
right.
who in terms of their health, they are rewarding themselves and you can see it. You know, there are people who their finances, they living from check to check, or they might have a low credit score, or they are overdrafting because it's a reward. It's like, I want this kind of car, so I'm not going to make no sacrifices. I'm just going to get the car. I want to live in it. And I'm like, yo, I get it now. That's why you're in poverty. And for me, it's like, it's for real. You can change what you know. So I like, look, I'm not trying to, I know that it's probably not the healthiest thing to do. But I can get to a point in my life because I was a vegetarian for 14 years. I used to fast for 14 days at a time. When I really want to change my health, I know how to do it. So if I want to go back to weighing 217 pounds, I'm 100% clear on what I need to eat, how often I need to eat, how I need to exercise. Like, I'm not clueless because I understand what I'm doing wrong. You are rewarding yourself when you're not putting in the work. So if there are 2,000,
that actually makes a ton of sense.
Yeah, I'm just saying. I think it's 2,000 calories that you have to eat. That's a pound. So for every calorie, it's 2,000. It's not rocket science. If you want to lose weight, you have to either work and run or walk, whatever you do, and lose so many calories, or you only eat so many calories, and then you can keep a certain weight. It's the same thing financially. It's the same thing in my relationship. I do not do the reward boy. In my marriage, like it is definitely work, reward. You feel me? So it just hit me that there are many
GMGs,
of you out
brother.
There. Huh?
Gotta earn them GMGs.
Yeah, for real. I promise you. And you know,
free.
some people may or may not have to. You know what I'm saying? But the reality though is a lot of you are in poverty and lack because in most areas of your life, you literally, poverty is rewarding yourself before you do the work. And wealth is doing the work and then rewarding yourself after you do the work. Like, and I just wanted to be able to simplify it so somebody could hear me and go, oh, I get it, E. So that's what I was telling C. And then his argument was that it's not necessarily reward, work. He felt that it was. What'd you say it was, C?
Well, I said it was belief.
Okay.
You know, and I don't even want to go to that first because I got so many questions about what you just said, just as I'm sitting here thinking about it and processing it in my own mind. I guess the first question I would ask you is it a conscious decision or an unconscious decision?
I think it's unconscious. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't think that you're really thinking about.
But do you think about when you, okay, for you, we're talking about food now.
Yeah.
When you eat that sandwich, that's a conscious decision or unconscious? Because I'm just trying to say it. If my, okay, let's say somebody else might be 142 pounds. They don't even really fool with food like that, right? Like, shout out to them, whoever they are. Praise God for you. But maybe their vice is like stuff. You know what I mean? So just like you, like, right. Yo, I'm about to go ahead and hit this chicken sandwich. They like, yo, I'm about to go ahead and cop another.
So can I say this to you?
$800 bet. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Can I say this to you? I think it's, I want to say to you, honestly, it's unconscious. Of course, I'm conscious now, but it's not something I started today. So when I used to do it back in the day, I wasn't conscious of the sandwich boy. Like, I'm eating sandwiches 24/7. The only reason I'm conscious of it now is because I'm 48 years old and my metabolism doesn't work. Like, it wasn't that the sandwich was bad when I was in my 20s or 30s. The sandwich wasn't bad. As a matter of fact, I'm going to be honest with you. I don't even eat as much as I used to eat then.
Right.
You
know what I'm saying?
I don't eat nowhere near as much as I used to eat.
Right.
But it costs me more.
Oh.
So the reality is,
talk about
yes,
it, Pastor.
I'm conscious, but I'm saying I wasn't conscious when it was happening. Like, sandwiches just became my thing, especially when you were where I was, homeless, or where I was financially. It's not like you're about to sit down and eat an 8-course meal. So you get what you can get. And sandwiches, like, the easiest thing, you know what I'm saying, for you to eat, and it's like, you know, it's not expensive. So I just had a habit of, okay, egg sandwiches, bologna sandwich, salami sandwiches, you know, hot dogs, like
fried bologna.
Egg sandwich.
Was it fried?
Fried bologna, bro.
Where you make the little top hat.
Oh, no question. With the cheese in the middle. You know what I'm saying?
So the edges burnt up.
Oh, bro. And so it just was a habit.
I'm about to go hit one of those right after the podcast.
When we get off the podcast. You know what I'm saying? Oh, and the turkey pastrami we used to do back in the day.
You had to have a little money for that, though.
Oh, you're right. We was coming
up at
that
time. You
got
to have a little money to go to the deli and ask for something.
Get the whole hookup. But we had to go to the daily, go to a daily because we didn't have it to get the big boy. We had to keep getting slices.
We couldn't afford the half a leg.
Hey, but don't play. Them slices lasted us like the week, though. Don't play.
Oh, no question. I remember we got real fancy. We would break out, go to E Crib and fry them jokers.
Depends on how many students came, though, by if we if the jokers last or not.
We could sneak on out.
And I used to be like, I'm like, why you hitting my sandwich when you got a calf? You got the calf blowout special.
Cafeteria right there.
Yeah, and you hitting the doggone sandwich. But I'd say, unconscious. For the majority of us, of course, like I said, now, of course, I'm conscious. But for the majority of the stuff that I've done, I was really unconscious because why? I grew up in a community where people who were living check.
Yeah,
check.
But you just I don't know if you, I guess you know it's not right and you see something going wrong, but I don't know you know the depths of it sometimes until you're bankrupt, right? Like you always kind of think you could fix it or make a change later, like. I know you and Didi, I don't know why, but ever since you and Didi always talk about my 600-pound life, now Candace and I watching it, and, people on there, you hear them talking like, man, it just kind of like spiraled. You know what I mean? Like,
no question.
Because you're like, okay, you 600. When you got to like 4, you might have been like, all right, cool, I'm done. You know what I mean? Like, let me slow this down. But like, it starts to spiral out of control. And that could be the same thing for your spending, your marriage, like, I don't want people to think we're just talking about weight here or even finances. Whatever your vice is or whatever that particular thing is, it can be hard to get control over. So for you, E, because obviously you are one of the greatest thought leaders of our times, if you're saying with your own situation with your weight, you're cool, obviously, and we're teasing. Obviously, E ain't like over there looking, you know, like he about to need an episode. You know what I mean? Like, but... how do you know for yourself, all right, cool, it's time to rein it back in? So how would somebody, and then how can I apply that to other areas of life,
oh,
if you
man,
will?
Oh, man, I'm not, why'd you go there, C? Why'd you go there? So here's the deal. I swear, I'm on everything I love. You know what I'm saying? I was in the groove doing my thing. And then it's not an excuse, but like, you know what I'm saying? We was traveling a lot, you know what I'm saying? Doing our thing. So of course I'm eating out every day. Like we was going from December to whatever, April. I'm eating every day, right? The only way I know is time. Cause like I said, I'm not lying to you. Like I'm not making this up. If anybody come to my church, they know I wear the black pants, the t-shirt. Bruh, I'm wearing the same jeans, see? I ain't got to get no new pair of jeans. I'm wearing the exact same jeans. But here's how I knew it was time to come back.
But the question is, are you in the same loophole of your belt?
Well, that's the only problem. I don't wear a belt, so that's probably why I don't know.
I was going to say, that's your belt loop will really tell you.
I'm about to say the exact same thing you said. But what I started doing when I was eating out regularly and I stopped working out, and this may sound stupid, bro. You might be like, yo, E, that's the most backward thing I've ever heard. But once I stopped working out regularly, I stopped getting on the scale.
Oh, of course.
I'm just saying, it don't make sense. I mean, for real. You would think it would be the opposite.
And I've told you regularly, when I stop working out is when I start eating. You just be like, ah, well.
The two go together.
My life is spiraling downhill fast anyway. Right. You know what I'm saying? I don't know what it is. You just double down on your stupidity.
I mean, it is real. And I want y'all to really hear what I'm saying. This week, like I said, I went running 2 miles. Why? I got on the scale and was like, oh, shoot. I done picked up 15 pounds since I got on the scale over whatever I was on the scale doing whatever I was doing. It was like 15 to 18 pounds. I was like, yo, when did that happen?
On the scale.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, like, what are you doing?
The scale is a real, you want an accountability partner? That scale.
Oh, the scale ain't no joke.
Oh, yeah. that scale will tell you. And you can, let me tell you something. I done had fights with my scale. I done been like, no, sir. Now you hold on. Let me. I'm gonna go run to the bathroom. Come right back because this can't be right. Because I've been eating solid for 2 days straight, and you trying to tell me I picked up a couple? Oh no. Yeah. But it ain't gonna lie to you though. It's gonna keep you. It's gonna keep you accountable.
And the scale made me go, okay, E, you got to go back. Now here's the scary part. I already know what happens when I get here. See, I do what I'm supposed to do. But once I get back to where I'm comfortable, I'm like, yo, you could chill now. You know what I'm saying? You don't have to go that, you know, hard. And I went running, bro. I promise the easiest thing I've ever done. I was like hurt. Like, you should have done 3 miles. So it's not that my body ain't even don't know how to do it, or my body is like rejecting it. I ain't throwing up. I ain't tripping. I actually felt tremendous. But it wasn't until I got on the scale and went, you know what? I need to get on the scale to find out. And so for some of you, what you do, you don't check your bank account because you're hoping that you don't. You know what I'm saying? You just like, I don't even want to see it. You feel what I'm saying? You just like, I don't even want to see it. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not going to check the credit card.
I just
want to
wait till they roll my car off on the flatbed.
I promise you. For real. It's real. Until they give me an eviction notice. Like, so I think for real, it's, you know, like I said, it's the
reward. But let me ask you this. All right. So don't leave from there because I don't want to forget. Okay. So is it, so I see what you're saying. But then, okay. So that's true in the case of you with food or exercise, diet, whatever. So, but there's other areas of your life where you would be like equivalent to like, you know, a bodybuilder. You know what I mean? Like in terms of your discipline, right? So is it that you value those other things over your health?
Way more. You know what I'm saying? And I got to be honest. And I'm going to ask those of you who
I hope Sean ain't listening to this podcast.
I know that's right.
Sean, I'm sorry. I repent right now. I'm coming on the Model Health Show again very shortly.
Give me some time, Sean. Give me 45 days. I know I could get back to at least your show.
Does that make sense, though? Because you have these other areas of your life where you like, yo, I'm waking up at 3. I'm going hard for my wife and my family. When I get on the road to speak, I ain't, you know, doing nothing crazy. I'm on it. I'm locked in. And then it's like, you got this other area where it's like, all right, cool. I'm just going to be a little bit more laissez-faire. And so I guess explain that whole thought process.
No, so here for real, I'm being real. And I think I don't know who I was talking to about it. Carl might've been there, but I was saying that when I took the values test. So the first one, you know, the first part is great, but the second test is the values. And Chris had me and Didi take that maybe about almost a year ago, right? And the values test blew my mind. And I didn't even take it for like the reason of what I'm talking about right now, but I've been going over it a little bit, you know, every other month or so I'll go over it. And I realized the reason why I struggle in terms of my weight part is of all my tests, see, the lowest one, believe it or not, is my aesthetic value. So of everything on that test, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's the one that is the least, like, I'm low on aesthetics. You know, so you could, I mean, you pretty much look at,
in terms
at,
of
you
your
know, like
preference
said,
for someone else
define
or yourself.
That, e. Yeah, define that.
So just pretty much, you know, just in general, like how I would, meaning that you know, like the way somebody would look, whether it's their clothes or whatever. So I wouldn't necessarily choose a female because she a zero, you know what I'm saying? Like, or size one. Like, I'm not really an aesthetic dude. Like, I don't look at a car or look at things and go, oh, that's beautiful. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's not a strength of mine. So if I go into a room and you got like
you still
metal
ended
chairs,
up with a beautiful wife and Dilsey. Yeah. I'm talking about just incredibly
beautiful. But I'm just saying,
so,
like,
you know what I'm saying? I'm gonna call your bluff on that one, player.
Yeah, no. But what it's saying,
you know what I'm
not
saying?
That's not.
And I'm gonna try to save you all at the same time because
I didn't like where that was headed. No.
You know
I'm
what I'm saying?
Real.
I didn't like where the size zero and size one, and you're not attracted to good looks was headed.
It doesn't mean that.
I'm just saying, as your boy, I thought I'd throw that alley-oop in there. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I thought I drive a Cadillac. So it doesn't mean that you don't like it, but y'all remember, I didn't pick the caddy. It don't mean I don't
okay.
like it. But you said,
like, it's still appreciated.
Dig your way back out, player. Live the fight. It's like game seven now. You just got to a game seven.
No, I'm saying, if you remember, Carl, I was looking at the Suburban. I wasn't on no caddy. Yeah. I was like, yo, I'll take the Suburban. And C was like, yo, E, no, we're at a different level. You need to whatever. So it wasn't like I was like, oh, I despise the caddy. I just was like, yo, I see this as a functional vehicle. I'm not looking at the function and the style. But when C was like, yo, E, come on. And she brought it around. I was like, oh, yeah, that's fire. You know what I'm saying? I'll take it. You feel me? But my lowest one is aesthetic. So if it's between my character, my spirituality, and my weight, well, my weight would be the last one. It doesn't mean that. Like you said, it don't mean I let myself get out of control and be 600-pound life. I do have a limit where it's like, okay, E, you gone too far, you need to come back. But I never go too far with the character. I never go like that with the spiritual. Like, I never let my spiritual life get out of hand. I never let my character get out of hand.
Right.
But because my aesthetics is the low, I'll let that, like, that's not really on the radar. And something will have to happen for me to go, oh, just like we were in, I think it was Dallas, and Cole came in and was like, yo, E. No, it was Phoenix. Cole came in and was like, yo, E, this looks terrible, bro. People spend good money. Bro, where's the screen? Where I had a little small screen that my homie brought for free. He was like, bro, come on, you can't do that. And so after that first conference, I promise you, I didn't spend bread, or at least if I didn't have to spend money, I made the screen a priority, the black drapes a priority, the way the seating was, because he brought to me like, yo, E, I know you fire. I know our content gonna be fire, but you got a group of people coming in here that they will be paying attention to that hole in the wall, or they will notice, you know, that stain and whatever. So you gotta fix that. And Cole literally had those people come back at 10 o'clock at night, and they didn't leave to 2 o'clock in the morning rearranging a room. So I do think, for those of you who, like, I don't know, you taking this test, this values test, will at least help you, of the seven, look at which ones you're the strongest. I'll give y'all another example. C used to get on me all the time, like, yo, E, like, you always talking about, you know, like, you messing us up a little bit because there's a group that does care about money, and you just act like money ain't nothing. And I was just like, yo, that's the other, you got my aesthetic is the lowest, and then my economic one is about as close as that one, right? It's low. So me doing things for money is not necessarily my swag, right? But another instance, Cole was like, yo, E, your highest one is I think you call it altruistic, and it's what you do for people. Like, that's my highest one, like looking after others. And I remember him saying, like, E, I ain't trying to be funny, but if that's really yours, you're gonna have to get your economics up, because you can't send kids to college. That costs money. You can't buy computers. That costs money. So it was like, oh, okay, while that one may not be important to me, I still have to make that one a priority, because I can't do this one without that one. So I, to your point, C, I think a lot of people don't value certain things, and because they don't value it, and I don't know why you wouldn't value Like, you got to help me to understand the one, though, with spending more money than you have or living from check to check. Oh, that's what it is.
Maybe yeah, but you value- I could literally say the same thing to you. Like, I don't understand you not wanting to work out, take care of your body. I can't understand you wanting to
it's
eat butter cake
you value.
When your health is literally the most important thing you got, because none of this matters.
That makes sense. Yeah. Yeah. But I just thought about it too. If your aesthetics is the most important one, you would be more concerned about how people see you than what you really have in the bank, because they can't see what you have in the bank. So then if you bought stuff to make it look like you got something in the bank, you don't care what you have in the bank anyway. You care more about their perception of you than anything else. So, yep, absolutely. See, I feel you. It makes sense.
And I was going to say, E, so the one critical thing that, again, people just have to understand, all of these values and stuff, still they're based heavily on, like, your experience. You know what I'm saying? Like, how you were raised. Yeah. There's stuff that happens. Like, not to put him out there, but I remember AJ, see, from London. Like, AJ is, I'd consider AJ like a shark, and not in a bad way. AJ is about, like, let's just say, he's economic. You know what I mean? Like, his value, it would be economic. But when you talk to AJ, you understand how he grew up, and he was like, yo, I will never be in that circumstance again. He had a crazy upbringing. He and his mom had to literally, you know, fight for their lives to survive. And now when I see him operate, it's like he's high economic. So, like, it's so holistic. Like, it's weird. And the values thing is huge, because now it makes you think about, okay, why do I value this? You know what I'm saying? Like, what happened in my life? Like, you got to take it all into consideration. Because, there's somebody that just wants to buy that car because it make them feel completely different. It could get repoed next week. Back to the same reward. Like, I don't even care. I just need that feeling of somebody looking at me and feeling like I got this because of some of the experience that I had. You know what I mean? Yeah. That was stripped from me as a kid or something like that. So it's kind of tricky when you put it all together. There's something missing for somebody that's why they're doing that.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, so the next, piece of conversation I want to move to is, how much of it do you think is informational, or what portion of that do you think we could charge to being unaware, or and not just unconscious, but uneducated on the matter, right? Like, you see people who maybe grew up in extreme poverty and eating at McDonald's, or you know what I mean, just like every day, or I don't know, and I don't want to offend anybody or have a bad example, but just like, you know, they just doing like high C and Hawaiian punch every day. Like, you're not necessarily making a conscious decision like, oh, I know this is terrible for me, let me drink this or eat this. It's been passed down, right? You grew up in a family where, you know, whatever, you know, diabetes or, you know, just bad eating or whatever. And you kind of just, you know, your grandmother fried food every day, your mama fried food every day, you fried food every day. And so, when I say does that make sense? I'm gonna go more educational. I'm not aware. Not like I'm like you're you just said something that was deep. You said, I know exactly what I have to do to get back to. So therefore, you're making a conscious decision that I'll get to it when I get to it.
Yeah.
But if you said, yo, I'm chunky, I have no clue how to lose weight, like I really, you know, I've never even looked into it, or you know, there's a difference between making that conscious decision and then just being uneducated on the matter. And so what portion of people do you think are uneducated on the matter, and they go, oh, okay, my credit score is good enough to get an Escalade? Well, for sure then, let's go for it. Even though I don't have the money in the bank, they're not aware or educated on the fact that, hey, do you understand if you started an investment account right now with that extra $400 you're spending every month, you could have X amount, you know what I mean? Like, is it education huge. Or?
Yeah. So no, I think it's a combination of. Oh, my bad, Carl.
No. I literally, as you're talking, see, I'm just writing some stuff down. So I'm saying, I will give out of 100%, and this may sound weird to people, I would give information and knowledge probably only about 10%. Like, honest to God. So I'll say
20 stretching it.
Say it again?
No, I'd say 20% new information is stretching it. So 10% information, Carl, but like some new stuff that you ain't never heard, maybe I stretch it
maybe
to 20%.
20. So, and here's what I just said. I just wrote down, I just made this up, y'all. This is my like highlight of the week. I just call it a knee principle, like KNEE, knowledge or information, 10%. Exposure, I'd say 40%. And so these are the three things that I say you need, and effort, 50%. Like, if I were to break it down, those are the three that I say: knowledge, exposure, and effort. And the reason I'm saying it like that is
you just made that up on the spot?
I promise you, I just made it up. Oh, I literally just typed it out.
I'm about to let Carl do the Thursday call. Where did this come from?
Leave it to Carl to come up
and use knowledge as the KN. It took me a minute to follow, but that's fire. Sorry.
You know, I'm saying those are the three things that you need, dude, if you're going to be successful at anything. Like, and we started talking about effort. So, like, again, y'all kind of gave me the words. Effort, knowledge, and what was the other? Exposure. So, like, if you think about it for real, dude, knowledge is so much. Because, again, we're in the age where knowledge is too much, if you were to ask me. Like, we know too much right now. Like, my kids, your kid's telling you stuff that you didn't know until you was 10. And they're telling you at 4 and 5 years old. Like, knowledge is everywhere. Knowledge is not the problem anymore. You could go Google anything you want to. Like, I'm talking about anything you want to. And YouTube might have a video to show you how to do it. You see what I'm saying? We live in the information age right now. So information is not the factor. The exposure, I think, is huge. Let me use me as an example.
But don't you have to have the information to want to go get the information? Does that make sense?
Not necessarily. Okay. I'm saying you look at what Jamal's doing. That's
exactly
where
I was going. I'm just saying, like, we know about investing. We understand there's millions of people doing real estate. Let me just use the concept of investing, not real estate. We understand investing is you put some money down every month. Like, every working person has heard about this. You get what I'm saying? Like, for the most part, you work in a decent, let me say, career-style job for the most part. You've heard about investing and putting some money away, putting some money in a 401k. Like, that concept, it's not new. Like, you have this information. What happens is, until you get around somebody that's, like, prolonged exposure, now you see a Jamal, it's like, yo, like, he got something going on for real, for real. Like, what is he doing? So now you go for a little more information, and, it's almost like those two kind of go back and forth. It's like a cycle. Like, you get around Maul, it's like, yo, this is dope. Let me see what he's doing. Okay, cool. Get a little more information. You go back around Maul, and that kind of feeds itself. But at the end of the day, like you were saying at the beginning, 50% of this is effort. Now you still got to get up and go make this thing happen for you. So that's what I say. Those three things are all super, super important. I don't think you could do it without any of them. But I'd say, see, that information might be the lowest of, I'd say it is the lowest of all of them.
Yeah, no question.
I want to say this, though. I want to encourage those of you who are listening. You know what I'm saying? For real, some of you in a different category. And I really don't want you to look at yourself, whether it be finances, whether it be your fitness or your family, and go, you know, when I compare myself, we're not asking you to compare yourself.
Not at all.
You feel me? Like, I'm being real. So I had a conversation with LaShawn about a week or two ago. You know what I'm saying? I just like, yo, LaShawn, let me keep it 100 with you. Like, you got to understand who I am and what my role is. My role is to help you to be the best you can be, and you can take a licking and keep on ticking. So I'm going to give you way more than I get anybody else. Just because you can handle it, like you're not about to buckle under pressure, right? But I told her, I said, let me say this to you because I may not do this enough. I am super proud of you, and I'm probably more proud of you than any human that I know. But because of where you are right now in your life and where you started from, I was like, yo, LaShawn, you might be looking at somebody that's on floor 10, and you looking at them like, they're on floor 10, I'm on floor 9, I got to get to floor 10. I said, I'm going to keep it 100 with you. They're on floor 10, but quiet is kept between me and you with their family. They started on floor 8. They started on floor 8, and they had to climb 9 and 10. I like you, little Shauna. You was like under. You might have been like starting at negative floor 10 and got to floor 9. The stuff that you've been through, I don't know that the average person can have that exact same experience, life experience, and get through that. So some of you on the call, you like, man, I'm 225. Yeah, but everybody in your family, 500. So that 225 for you is amazing. And I don't want you to look at somebody that's 185 and cock diesel and go, like TJ say all the time. TJ say, like, for real, don't look at me and go, I want to be like TJ. TJ's like, yo, for real, I'm just being real. I eat crazy. Matter of fact, he was like, they just told me I could potentially have, you know, high blood pressure because of the way I eat. He's like, I can just eat it and it just runs straight through me. Like, it's not that deep. Everybody can't do that. So if some of you on the call, for real, you like, man, I only got $1,000 in my bank account. All your family is bankrupt, you know, was into being in and out of jail on some fraud stuff. Like, do not hear this conversation the wrong way. You are killing the game. Based on where you come from and where you are murdering the game. So we're not We don't want you to overexert yourself or look at yourself in the mirror and say, well, because I'm not doing the investments like ETA, then I'm not. No, that's not the truth. You might be killing it. All we're saying to you is that you got to be aware, because if you are aware, we can go from where we are and go to a whole nother level. So I could go to a whole nother level if I wanted to in my health, right? It's just a sense of, all right, E, are you willing to put in that effort? I'm gonna be honest with y'all. Sometimes, and y'all gotta hear this in me, because you don't hear it enough from me. And it's a reason why you don't hear it from me, because I want you to quit and give up. But there are legitimately times in the course of the month or a year where I just go, E, to 3 o'clock in the morning, you know what I'm saying? To trying to keep your character strong, to trying to be there for people. Like, it is, I was talking to Roy yesterday, I was like, yo, Roy, yo, I see why my old dude just spazzed out on the you know, on the candy. Like, you get to a point where you work so hard that even though you're getting good results, there are times where with just the health, boy, I'm just like, okay, E, for real, bro, like, I'm tired. You know, I'm tired of doing the right thing. You know what I'm saying? That don't mean I'm about to go out here and do something I'm supposed to do, but in the area of eating, I'm like, all right, I'm about to hit this chicken real quick. You know, or, yep, I was a vegan, and like C said, yo, I was on the road 24/7 doing the vegan thing. It's just like, it became a hassle. Like, it became more of a struggle for me to try to find a restaurant. I'm like, yo, bro, like, it's hard. You know what I'm saying? It's hard when you are in Cali time zone, then you in Utah time zone, then I'm in Australia, or I'm in the UK, and I'm flying right back from the UK. It's like, yo, my man hit me like, you want vegan? I'm like, bro, I'll be there for 25 hours, bro. Like, no, I do not want to eat like that. I'm on the plane. They serving food. I'm like, I'm eating. Like, I'm not about to sit on the plane for 8 hours and starve myself. So we're letting you know, you're human. Why are we pushing you? Because we want the best for you. We want the best out of you. So don't sit here and hear us and go, I'm the worst person in the world. I'm overweight, my whatever. We are human. We all got in an area where we're struggling in. All we're saying is, like, rest if you must, for real. You know, cheat if you must. You know what I'm saying? Have a cheat day. I'm eating cookies and whatever. But we're saying, don't make it a lifestyle. Like, don't get to the point where you surrender, you give up, you quit. Like, you don't want to do it no more. Yes, you're going to get you're gonna get tired. Yeah, you're going to feel burnt out. I was on campus yesterday walking, and I was thinking about the PhD. And I was just like, yo, I remember the days where I was just burnt out. And I'm like, I'm not writing today. I'm not studying no more today. I'm not doing it no more. If it takes me 8 years and it takes somebody else 4 years, who cares? I'm going to finish this PhD, but I'm not going to die in the process. Like, I'm not going to stroke out in the process. So we're just telling you, rest if you must. Take a break if you must. But at the end of the day, get back up. And if you know that this is where your best was, like, I know my best is 215, 217. Like, that's my best. When I get to 212, my girl, like, you like a crackhead. I need you to put some weight on. So I know what my best is. My best is 217. So it's like, okay, E, when you get to 230, that's not your best, E. And so you can't keep eating the way you eat. You can't not work out. You got to get back to your best, E. And I'm going to be real with y'all. I didn't wake up and go, I'm about to get 217. I didn't say that. I was like, yo, E, you got 2 weeks. Get out of 230. You got 2 weeks. Get out of 230. I don't care what you are, 229, 228.5. It doesn't matter. Just get out of the 230s, right? And then when you get in the 220s, we'll work out a plan once you get to the 220. But just get out of the 230s. And that's all we want y'all to know today. It's just like, at some point, you cannot spiral out of doggone control. In the 600-pound life, I'm not even tripping on them. Me and C was teasing. We saw a meme the other day that said 90% of the people who own my 600-pound life, they in relationships, flat out. We ain't watched one
so
yet.
So I'm about to go where, eat a sandwich.
You feel me? We ain't watched one yet where they like in the house by themselves. They got a spouse who feed them. Somebody going to get their meals for them.
With kids.
You feel me?
A lot of them got
and
kids.
And them people need to be arrested.
Well, that means you got to arrest me too.
I normally don't believe in accessory in that particular fashion, but man, come on, man. I'll be like, look, I'm bringing you a salad, doggone. You eating this salad, and I don't care what, you can't fight me. You know what I'm saying? Like, duh, you know what I'm saying? Like, you could really stage your own intervention right there. Okay, I've gone too far. I don't mean to offend. I'm just telling y'all my inner thoughts as I'm watching. You can, no, I'm no saying, question. My man, his girl was just bringing him large pizzas. I'm like, okay, now you done got out of hand. You can't just, you know what I'm saying? Like, no.
That must be love.
No, I'm saying, yeah, you done got, hey. Back on track. I was going to say something.
I'm just saying, Carl, they're in relationships, Carl. They're not like single. They're not by themselves. They're in relationship. Wow. So, but what we're saying is something spiraled out of control. Like C said, you got on it and you was 400. All we saying to you is when you
I see how it happens, though.
No question.
Let me tell you something.
I saw the sandwich yesterday.
I'm one piece of willpower away from needing the intervention. You know what I'm saying? Where y'all like, yo, C. You know what I'm saying? Because I promise you, I don't like working out like that. I know some people like, yo, I just, you know what I'm saying? It's like, no, I do it for the discipline. But I promise you, I'm plenty good with a bacon, egg, and cheese biscuit, some hash browns, and laying in the bed watching more. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, the inner part of you, you just do it because, you know, you got that discipline. So, the other thing, and I want, maybe it's too late to add this in.
No, go for it.
So my point to E, in all seriousness, let's get back to the serious stuff. My point to E was, I also believe that this is as big a component, if not stronger, Carl, that people lack the belief that if I try to do something, my situation will change anyway. Right? Like, so I just believe that one of the reasons that we stayed together in this company for years without getting a check was that we believed that one day it wouldn't look the way it looks now if we continued to work.
Right.
And so I believe, back to my 600-pound life, if you're 600, chances are you've tried to lose weight a few times and it didn't work. So you lose the belief that me trying to do something is really going to help anyway. So somebody who's been in poverty forever and tried saving their money and they saved up $300 and their car caught a flat tire, and the windshield cracked, and they had to get the windshield fixed and the tire fixed. Yeah. They go, damn, not only did I blow through my whole 300, I had to borrow 100 from my friend, and now I'm 100 in the hole after I tried to save. You know what? It's not worth it. If I told you right now, Carl, again, it's to your point. What did you say to the young lady in Australia? She said, I got a problem with procrastination. You said, no, you don't have a problem with procrastination. It's not important to you. You said, if I told you to meet me tomorrow at 8 a.m. right here in this exact same place and I give you $1 million, where would you be tomorrow at 8 a.m.? And she said, matter of fact, I'd be right here at 7 a.m. waiting on you to get here at 8, right? Because it would be the belief that if I actually show up, that my situation is going to change. And so therefore, E, my only point to you was, if you don't show up and you know you need to show up, it's because you believe that it's easier to just not show up anyway because the chances are it's not going to change. And so that was my point to you is, again, people in poverty, people who have tried to lose weight, and I know we're using these examples, people who have tried to fix their marriage, right? Like, they don't believe that going to counseling is going to fix their marriage, or else they go. If you believe that going to counseling will actually have you and your spouse on another level and increase happiness in your life, you'd go to counseling. But the bottom line is, one of y'all probably sitting there going, man, I'm not listening. I'm not going to no counselor telling them my problems just to hear them say, because in your mind, you don't think it's going to work. If I think it's going to work, if I was sitting there and I'm overweight and I go, all right, cool. If I really stick to this in 5 months, I'm going to look like this, or I'm going to have lost this much weight guaranteed, I think those people would do it. But what happens is, we run up against rejection so many times, it's almost like the horse who's used to being, is it the horse? Used to being on that leash. Yeah. And it's like you tried to, you were tied to a pole. Yeah. And you tried to walk away like 5 times and it got snatched back. Eventually, you could just take the pole away and it ain't gonna go nowhere. And it's kind of the same situation, I feel like, for humans as we build up a callus to failure, to poverty, to overweight, to any of these extreme conditions that we may be going through. We lose the belief that our action actually makes a difference anyways, and so it creates inaction, and we just go, it is what it is. I might as well eat this cheeseburger. I'm fat anyway. I might as well go buy this, you know, $500 belt, even though I had no business. I'm gonna be broke anyway. At least it'll make me feel temporarily good. At least the cheeseburger will make me temporarily feel good, as opposed to hanging on to this fantasy that one day I'm gonna live my greatest dream. I'm tired of trying to do that, so let me get these temporary fixes. Does that make sense?
Hmm. Oh, it does. Yeah. But my point, though, Carl, is, yeah, you're right. But I think there's another group. I believe there's another group like myself who not only believes but knows. And I just sometimes say, effort-wise, is it worth it? So I do believe. Doggone, I believe in the treadmill. I know what the treadmill can do. I know what running long distance can do. But sometimes I wake up some months and it's just like, yo, if I could just get up and go to the treadmill. But some days I get up and it's a doggone emergency. Another day I get up and I got to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning and go drive to the airport. You know what I'm saying? It's just like, yeah, I know running works, but I got so much going on in my life. You know what I'm saying? And so many obstacles that sometimes are just like the effort to do it is just like, yo, it ain't worth the effort for me to put it in. And I think some people, like, now this ain't all y'all. Some of y'all need to give us a call. Extreme Execution, for real. You know what I'm saying? etinspires.com/execution. And you need to take the assessment, and you and your wife need to get on the phone and get through it. But there's some of you who you need to holler at me on some E. I know it can work. I just don't feel like the work, working on the inner me or working on this situation. Like, I just don't feel like putting in the work to get here. So I'm gonna throw my hands up. So yep, there's a belief, but there's another group of y'all. Y'all know it'll work, but you are just tired of trying. You are tired of getting up in the morning and putting the shoes on and going down to the treadmill or whatever it is. Like I said, for me, my biggest struggle is, And I tell, because, you know, I work with Rochelle, and I'm like, Rochelle, I swear to you, if I was home 2 weeks in a row, I'd kill it. But Rochelle, it's the, I got to get up and get on the road. You know, I got to be at the airport for 6 a.m. So I got to leave super early to catch the traffic before they go. And then I get to the hotel and I got to go speak and I got to talk to 1 million people. And so by the time I get back at night, I don't feel like getting on the treadmill because I've worked with so many people. But if I was at home for a straight 30 days, I would kill it, but I'm not. And so the taking clothes and my clothes spoil or you know, whatever it's called, like I'm sweating and I don't have a washing machine at every hotel. And now I'm hanging stuff up and in my shoe and I just like, yo, for real, I just got to a point of burnout where it's like, if I could just go straight treadmill, I would kill it. But it's all the other obstacles that aren't necessarily bad because I make good money and my wife is happy and my kids have to go to school and I don't have a house note. So I'm not making those things bad, but it's like those things that make my other life great makes this aspect of my life bad. And it's just some months I'm killing. I'm like, let's go. I will fight through it. And then other months, y'all out there, y'all like me, other months you just like, yo, I'm exhausted. Like I don't have enough energy to have a great marriage, to make great money, to have a phenomenal church, to, you know what I'm saying, killing it with ETA. I just don't have the energy to do all that and do this. But I'm telling y'all, that's why I said rest if you must. But what I cannot do, what CJ said, I cannot get to a point where I say I don't care anymore and let that sucker spiral till I'm 300 pounds because I could get there easy. I can't do that. I got to say, all right, E, enough is enough. All right, we got to go back in this direction. So I know some of y'all are tired, and we're not telling y'all push, push, push till you die. We saying rest, but you got to have a governor. You have to have a point where you say, I can't let my marriage go like this, because if I keep going, my wife's going to be with somebody else. My husband's going to be with somebody else. You know what I'm saying? If I keep going like this, I'm going to be bankrupt. If I keep going like this, I will be obese and put my physical health at risk. You got to have a governor and say, enough is enough, and start going back toward the right, going back in the right direction.
Yeah, no question.
Hey, and I'll just add, for real, E, it's you have to include the exposure. And for some people, this is a mm-hmm. tough part because you just got to get around. Like, there's a dude that was on one of our calls recently, and my man said, like, honestly, I need help stopping smoking weed. He was just transparent. And we asked him a question, like, how many people around you smoke weed? Oh, all my friends. Well, there it is. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're not going to stop, dude, if it's all around you. So I'm saying, like, it's hard enough, like E's saying, to be, you know, internal and disciplined and all that on your own. It's tough. And then your environment not helping. Like, we're talking about a 600-pound life. Like, your environment's not helping. You eating the same stuff. Everybody else around you pretty much big, your family big. You know what I'm saying? It's not going to help you. So if information alone is not going to get you, the next thing you have to do is you got to get at least one other person that's, like, the extreme opposite of what you are. Like, you just talk to them once or twice a week. Like, just make that a point.
They're I'm going to live with Jamal opposite. In his basement.
I'm being real. Whatever you got to do, just Jamal find somewhere to get exposed to that.
No, they left here in the afternoon. He said they got home at 1. I looked at my phone, saw 1:30. Of course, when I woke up, 1:30, he said, yo, bro, we made it in. We good, because they drove. He sent me a picture at 5:30 in the gym with his trainer.
Yep.
First of all, I'm like, who training you? You know what I'm saying? Like, what kind of animal is this to train the trainer? But anyway, no, he was getting to it again. But that there go to show you what he values. You know what I'm saying? Yep. Like, yeah, you done got four. I'd have called my trainer from the car. I'm like, look here, buddy. you, congratulations. You got tomorrow off. You know what I'm saying? But just a different level, dog. Just a different level. All right, man. I had a whole bunch of stuff I wanted to do today, man. I got all the negative feedback here. I got a bunch of questions, but y'all talked entirely too long,
yeah,
I think.
You're right.
And I got stuff to do. The kids got to swim.
Hey, Didi just told me I had to stop.
Oh, I heard Didi. I heard Didi come in like, all right, that's enough. Wrap it up, yeah.
That's enough.
Hey, you know what you don't have to stop?
Never. Organifi.
You know what you never have to stop, E?
I'm sorry. What do I never have to stop, C?
Thank you. Goodness gracious. You leave me out here on a ledge. Golly. Nice to have you here podcasting with me. Organifi. You never have to stop taking Organifi, okay? You know why? Because it's so darn good for you, okay? All the essential nutrients, micronutrients that you need are packed into this thing, man. Organifi is the superfood green juice powder that we've been using, but it's not just the green juice, man. Y'all heard us talk about the red juice, the gold. Man, they got the protein powder. Whatever you need, they have, man. This is a company that we've been with for, you know, quite some time. Again, we started off as just fans, right? Like, shout out to Sean Stevenson, who we mentioned earlier. You know, he just put us on it, and he was sending us some, like, hey, try this stuff, and we loved it, loved the way it made us feel. And so Sean made the connection and said, hey, these guys got a good podcast too, man. Would you be interested in sponsoring? And they've been a sponsor ever since. And, you know, the relationship works so well. We love what they do for us. They love what we do for them, that they've been sponsoring this podcast for quite some time now. So shout out to our sponsor, Organifi. Because they love us so much, they give y'all a free code just for being great listeners of the podcast. You can go to Organifi.com, Organifi.com. Use the promo code SUCCESSMAN and get 20% off your first order. Shout out to Organifi for being a loyal sponsor and a great partner in this podcast endeavor. So if y'all enjoy the podcast, enjoy listening, man, go check them out. Show them some love as well. Also, man, the Verified Conference, man, super pumped about that. I've been getting so many texts and emails about the Verified Conference. People just super pumped about it. E, can you tell us very quickly why you wanted to do the...
No!
The,
okay.
Not quickly. Hey.
Okay. Not very quickly. I don't care. It's on Didi. My wife, I'm good. She ain't said nothing yet.
I'll try, though. Hey, guys, no, for real. I told you. You know, CJ got on my head about, all right, E, the character's good, you know, the inspiration, motivation, but, you know, you don't act as if, from a financial standpoint, we have not been blessed as a result of us being in our lane, you know, and working
even
our
if
lane.
My card is still getting declined at Cheesecake Factory.
You feel me?
I'm still being blessed.
If you just pay for yourself, stop balling and paying for
some
all
more
the
than others
around you.
You know what I'm saying?
You know what I'm saying? You balling and paying for everybody.
Well,
table.
It was lunch. It was the lunch menu. I figured everybody was, you know, nobody was drinking or nothing. So I figured now was as good a time as any. You know what I'm saying?
They still going heavy, bro. They still top heavy. Got to be cautious. But C's been like, you know, like, yo, E, man, for real. Like, just be balanced, bro. Like, don't exclude an area that's real. And I was like, you know what? See, you're right. Being able to connect with our audience, you know, being able to find our platform, you know, being able to network, you know, all of these different things, this plan that C put together for me, then put together for Tobe, is like, yo, for real, Tobe is in a different space in terms of his influence, his impact, and his finances. You know, married with a daughter, brought his daughter not into poverty. He brought his daughter into this world with wealth. And so I was like, you're right, C. So we need to give others that exact same blueprint. So for those of you who feel like Toby, like myself, like Willie Moe Jr., Karen Civil, you know, like QDZ, if you have a gift and you don't have, like your mom, how did your boy say it? My mama thought I was a joke. But Miss Badu thought I was dope. Like, if you need to be a part of a community that will recognize your gift, and not only recognize your gift, support you in your gift and not only support you, but show you how to create a platform with that so that you can be financially successful. You can have influence, impact in the world. You need to be in Philly, for real. You need to be in Philly because each one of these individuals are going to share with you their story of how they did it. And more importantly, after the conference, we have content, hours and hours and hours of content, workbooks that you guys will be able to invest in that will give you the tips and the tricks that you can work on daily. So this isn't it's inspiration for a day, pumping you up, motivate you, but we're literally going to give you the tools. And then for those of you who are like, yeah, that's cute, the day or two, but I want to continue. They're going to give you the same format CJ's been using, you know, with the Masters of the Game, Game Changers, the weekly calls, EB, all of that. He's going that same platform we're going to use to help you in terms of your gifts. So you got to be there.
Yep, no doubt. Looking forward to it, man. It's going to be a blessing, man. And shout out to everybody who's going to be there with us, Toby. Like you said, just Willie. Big things popping, man, and big celeb thing, stuff. Karen Civil, who's incredible. I believe she was in charge of running like a bunch of campaigns, and she's heavy with the brands. Knows everybody, so hopefully, you know, it's going to be a great conference, man. We're excited about that. Also, Phenomenal Life Mexico 20, PhenomenalLife2020.com. Come to Mexico with us, man. We're going to have a great time in Mexico. Man, the cruise first, not then Jamaica, not Mexico. I told you, I'm going down there just to test it out before we even get down there. I'm taking my wife down to Mexico, Maya Riviera. If you've never been there, it's incredible. If you've been there, you know how incredible it is. And we want you to join us back. I just heard, I don't know, but everybody who's been looking up the resort, you know, has said that it's been incredible. So go look it up for yourself, man, and see what we're going to do, man. We have such a great time. I know we joke a lot. We laugh a lot. If y'all like the podcast, the trips are like a big extension of the podcast, man. Yeah. We just have a blast. Yeah. So look forward to seeing you there. Anything else, Carl, that I'm missing? Help me out here. Game Changers, of course. You want to be down with the Game Changers. Learn how to take your passion, turn it into a profit from a speaking standpoint. We'd love to see you there. ETAGameChangers.com.
You down with MOG?
Yeah, you know me. You know what I'm saying?
You down with MOG.
Did I miss anything, Carl?
Hey, just ETInspires.com. We're trying to do a better job of keeping everything direct.
And we got a special announcement coming soon that we can't say yet, Carl. With a project that we were working on that I'm excited. I saw it though, Carl. I don't know if I told you, but I did see it, and it is out of bounds sweet. So,
yes, sir. Don't miss a podcast, y'all.
Don't miss that. I promise you, I'm looking at the negative feedback right here, y'all. We will get to it. I just have ran out of time today, but I do have it right here, and I have your questions. There's some good questions in here as well. So I'm going to get to those, but the conversation kind of took on a life of its own. Hey, at the end of the day, what did we learn today? E-back chunk, return of the Mac. You know what I'm saying?
Return of the Mac.
Hold on. Let me play it. Hold on. You know what I'm saying?
Hey.
Return of the Chunky. Okay? He's back, but not for long. Not for long. He's going to be back, you know, doing this thing. He's going to be skinny by the end of the summer. But for now, return to the Mac.
Because you know what that means, see? If I'm skinny by the end of the summer, it means no more.
Hey, but just live, though. Warm butter cake. Hey, I told you, man.
No more warm butter cake.
It's a little bit more joyful. You got a little bit more, you're a little bit more jolly. You know what I'm saying?
More energy.
You got a little, Saint Nick. You know what I'm saying? You got a little extra jolly spirit around when you got the little extra gut around the midline. So we forgive you, E, as much as you do for the world, doggone it. You deserve a sandwich, doggone it.
Yes,
you put
sir.
Your life on the line for the world every day, getting up at 3. The least you should be able to do is hit a chicken sandwich with barbecue sauce slathered over the top of it. You know what I'm saying?
So
return of the Mac. And, hey, man, we just appreciate y'all listening to this podcast. Hey, everybody always asks, how can I, you know, be a blessing? Y'all been such a blessing to me. Just share it, man. Tell your friends, your family members, whoever you can to take a listen to us, man, if you like it. Also, go to iTunes, leave us that review. E, hit us with that nugget of the day. No pun intended. You know what I'm saying? No pun intended, E.
No pun.
nuggets of the day.
Fat Joe. Fat Joe. I just crush a lot. Oh, man. Yeah, y'all, for real. Whew, you heard me say it the whole doggone podcast. Like, for real, give me a governor, y'all. Don't let it spin out of control, you know? For real. And there's some of you, you at that point right now, you know, where I watched 600-pound, my 600-pound life, and they're on a liquid diet. Like, don't get to the point where you're forced. You know what I'm saying? You forced because we've indulged so much that we can't even eat no more. You know what I'm saying? Now we gotta be on a liquid diet, you know, and that's in everything, in your marriage, in your finances, whatever. Like, don't get to the point where somebody else has to take control of your life because you lost control. You know what I'm saying? You lost control. Whatever, like I said, whatever it is, marriage, whatever is your mind, you let stress you out, and now you got to take medication, or you high blood pressure, and you're on 6-7 pills a day. Like, don't governor. You know what I'm saying? Like, get to a point where you like, enough is enough. And you can turn that thing around, because for real, if you can't turn it around, somebody else gonna have to turn it around. You know, ICU might, you know what I'm saying? A physician might have to turn it around, or they might repo your house, take your car. Your kids can't go to college because you've ruined your credit. You feel me? So do me a huge favor, turn it around now. You have the power to turn it around. So as I'm speaking right now, write that thing down that has gotten out of control, put a plan together, get you an accountability partner, and turn it around. Hey, let's go.
Let's get it.
Hey, we love you. Appreciate y'all listening. We'll see you next week.
Right now, don't you worry about when you get home. You make that, you concentrate on this opportunity. You don't worry about tomorrow. You concentrate on this opportunity with all your might, with all your soul.